Daniel 9:24 through 27. 70 weeks have been decreed for your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to make an end to sin, to make atonement for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. So you are to know and discern that from the issuing of a decree to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until Messiah, the prince there will be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. It will be built again with plaza and moat, even in times of distress. Then after 62 weeks, the Messiah will be cut off and have nothing, and the people of the prince who is to come will destroy the city and the sanctuary, and its end will come with a flood. Even to the end there will be war. Desolations are determined. And he will make a firm covenant with the many for 1 week, but in the middle of the week he will put a stop to sacrifice and grain offering. And on the wing of abominations will come one who will make desolate, even until a complete destruction, one that is decreed, is poured out on the one who makes desolate.
Okay, as we left Daniel last week, he had been stricken ill by the vision he had seen, by what God had given him, but yet it said he picked himself up and continued to minister unto the king. With all these thoughts of all these beasts running through his mind, have you guys dreamed about beasts in your sleep at night as much as we've talked about them? Somebody has. Okay. But before we pick up the story for today, we need to do some sorting, because we've talked before about the chronological order of these books. Remember, we have Nebuchadnezzar in the first four chapters, and in chapter 5, we move to the next king of Babylon, which was Belshazzar. The end of chapter 5, he dies. Darius the Mede defeated Babylon and the Medo-Persian Empire, follows through 6. But then we jump back and start talking about Belshazzar again. And now we're still on that last week. And today we jump back again to the first year of Darius. So if you're trying to keep track of all that, you got it in order, right? Well, let me make it easier. The chronological order so far is 1, 2, 3, 4, 7, 8, 5, 9, 6. Or 6, 9 can switch. Okay, you ever got that straight? Now, I put out there, or it could be 6-9. Both of those take place the same year, so we don't know which one comes first. Now, this chapter begins with Jeremiah's prophecy, okay, and concludes with Daniel's third vision concerning God's program for Israel's future, and it culminates in the Messiah's reign. So we're covering a big period of time in this book. And verses 24 through 27, how many of you brought your Bibles up here? One person, good for you, because you need to put your finger in chapter 9. If the rest of you have got Bibles, you probably ought to run and get them, because you may be wanting to look at them as you go through here, because I don't put the scriptures all up there for you. So, as we come to today's lesson, we find that we can find out that Daniel does his daily Bible studies. You ever stop and think about that? Here's Daniel, and what's he doing? He's studying the scriptures, even though he's in it now. And he is studying from Jeremiah. And he ran across some interesting things in these two chapters, Jeremiah 25, 11, and 12. Now listen carefully. I'm going to read these, and I want you to see if you can figure out what Jeremiah finds that just really grabs his attention. It says, "And this whole land shall be desolate and a whore, and these nations shall serve the king of Babylon 70 years. Then it will be when 70 years are completed, I will punish the king of Babylon and that nation, declares the Lord, for their iniquity and the land of the Chaldeans, and I will make it an everlasting destitute. And then later he says, for thus says the Lord, when 70 years have been completed for Babylon, I will visit you and fulfill my good word to you to bring you back to this place. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord's plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and come pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me, and when you search for me with all your heart, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord. And I will restore your fortunes and will gather you from all nations and from all the places I have driven you, declares the Lord. And I will bring you back to the place that I sent you to exile. Now, did you notice what Daniel noticed? Did you notice what was interesting to him? Well, you know what Daniel did? He grabbed a calculator and started figuring this out. He said, I was taken captive in 605 BC. Got to be figuring this out, guys. And he said, today's date is 538 BC. I've been in captivity for how long? Come on, guys. Can't you take 605 and subtract 538? What do you come up with? 67. So he says, I've been in captivity 67 years. And what does Jeremiah say how long it's going to be? 70 years. It's getting close to the end. And you know what else Daniel discovers? He discovers that the scripture said, then you will call upon me and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you know what? Daniel got down on his knees and started praying. Now, there is one problem when Daniel was figuring this out. By the way, can you stop and think about how old Daniel is now? He's been in captivity 67 years. And he was somewhere between 13 and 16 when he went into captivity. He's in his 80s by now. And still serving in government. Still serving the kings. There's several lessons we can discover from Daniel's reaction to this new understanding. Oh, by the way, there were three problems that he had is there were three rounds of taking captives from Israel. And then there were four, I didn't get that written down right there. And then there were four commands to allow them to return. Now, two of these, if you figure them together, two of the taking captives and two of the returns, both come out at 70 years. And I think that's interesting because it tells us that when God gives a prophecy, he's true to that prophecy. Okay, there's several lessons we can discover about Daniel from this. One, he believed in a literal interpretation of prophecy. He believed what said was going to happen. He didn't say, 3 years, wonder what's going to happen. And then sit down and wait to see if it was going to happen. He did something about it. He realized that this would only come to pass through prayer. That's what God told him in Jeremiah. That the people would pray and then it would happen. And third, he realized the necessity for confession of sin. And so those are things that he did. Daniel's response to the discovery that the end was drawing near is he entered into a prayer. And we're going to go over this pretty quick because the part we want to get to is later. But I do want to touch on this anyway. Daniel's prayer is verses 4 through 19. And as he began to prepare for praying, The first thing he did is he said, I set my face unto the Lord God. In other words, he put everything else away. He turned off the TV, turned off the radio. He shut people out of his mind, and he concentrated on God. Now, how often do we pray and we get interrupted and we have all these other things going on that grab our attention? Daniel made sure there was nothing that would happen. He set his face unto the Lord God to seek, it says him. He was seeking for answers to the prayer and answers that had been promised in God's word. His humility is shown in the fact that he fasted, he clothed himself with sackcloth, and he covered himself with ashes, showing the humility as he got before God. His prayer began, and by the way, there's some lessons in prayer here for us too. It begins with a prayer of confession. Now, he's not really talking about his own sin as much as he is confessing the national sin of Israel. He realized all they've done throughout their history that has been gone. And he goes back and he starts praying about it one at a time. Second, he points to the fact, and he talks about the fact that they had disregarded the prophets. And as God punished them for that, sending them to captivity and things like that, it was just. That God was just in doing what he had done to them. Next, he compares the righteousness of God to the sins of Israel. Boy, there's a big difference there. How Israel acted and how God acted in righteousness. He itemizes a lot of the sins of Israel and how God had punished them each and every time. And yet God always kept his word. When he told him he would bring them back from captivity or from the persecution from another nation, he always did that. He always rescued them, but yet he also punished them as he promised. The next thing as he did was he petitioned for forgiveness and restoration. He realized how much they needed forgiveness. He prays that God will bring them out of captivity just like he brought them out of the land of Egypt. Once before, when they were in Egypt, he brought them out of that captivity, and he prays that God is going to do that for them again. He appeals to the mercies of God. You know, that's the only hope we have, is that we have a merciful God. It was a merciful God that gave Jesus to die for us. He asks for the restoration of the sanctuary and worship of God. And last of all, and I want you to listen to his plea. He says, O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action. This is a man that is down on his knees praying for God's forgiveness and to bring restitution to his land. As we leave Daniel praying, I want to stop and a minute and ask a question. Something that I think we need to consider in our lives. Daniel sees that the time of captivity is quickly drawing to an end. And he lays aside everything else to fervently seek God in prayer, preparing himself for what is about to happen. As we look around us in our world today, we see everywhere signs that Jesus Christ will return soon. And how are we reacting? Are we reacting the same way that Daniel reacted when he found out the end was near? The end of this world is near too. The time of our salvation, the end of it is near. And how are we responding to God? Are we fervently seeking God in prayer? Or are we too busy right now and we're going to get to it a little later? So while Daniel is still praying, God sent the angel Gabriel to him. And by the way, do you know when Gabriel was sent to Daniel? It was not after the prayer was over. He sent Gabriel when Daniel started praying. That's the indication in the scriptures. Daniel started praying, and he immediately sent Gabriel. Gabriel arrived about the time of the evening oblation, which is the evening sacrifice, which would have been about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And his purpose was twofold. His first was to give Daniel skill and understanding what he was about to tell him, because it could be difficult. And second, to show Daniel that he was loved. God loves when people want to talk to him and be together with him and spend time with him. I love what Daniel is told. He says, "I have come to tell you that you are highly esteemed." What a testimony to Daniel's integrity and to his character that God looks at him and esteems Daniel very high in his view. It challenges us to question ourselves and ask, does God esteem us that way too? Is our dedication that deep? Now this brings us to the exciting part for Daniel and also for us, and also to the difficult part. And that's the 70 weeks of Daniel. Okay, this is why you might want to take your Bibles and look, because a lot of this is coming directly out of those verses. And we're going to have to do some figuring with your calculators to figure this all out and maybe get confused a little time. Okay, the basic facts are, by the way, how many weeks is he talking about? He told Daniel, how many weeks is determined on his people? If you can read, it's up there twice. He says 70 weeks are determined on your people. Okay? What is accomplished when that week has been fulfilled? This is in verse 24. Goes over here on this side of your chart, because this side of the chart over here is when it's going to be done. We start over here. This is where it's done. He says, when it's done, these are the things that's going to happen. It's going to finish transgression. It means when the 70th week is over, Israel's course of apostasy, sin, and wandering is going to be over. They will have done it, and it will be done for them, that part of their national heritage. Second, it is to make an end to sin. The idea here is they're going to seal up sin so sin can't get out anymore. So we're protected from sin. It's removed. Third, it's to make atonement for iniquity. It's kind of the picture of Jesus Christ on the cross dying for us. To bring in everlasting righteousness. See, you can preach this as well as I can, because it's right from the scripture. It comes through Jesus, and it's probably a reference to the messianic kingdom. Will there not be any influence to sin or anything like that? It's everlasting righteousness, and all through the eternal kingdom. The fifth one is what? Right, to seal up vision and prophecy. I want you to stop and think about that. What's he saying? He's saying by the time that the 70 weeks are over, all of the prophecy and visions that we need will be over too. We don't need any more because we're going to be living with the Lord. It's going to be totally different. But it's to seal up, to say we don't need any more, it's done. And last of all is, anoint the most holy place, or anoint the holy place. What he's talking about probably is in the kingdom, there's going to be a millennial kingdom. It's talked about in Ezekiel. The description is given there. There's going to be a millennial kingdom, and it will be that the millennial kingdom, the whole most holy place, will be anointed and will be prepared for service. Okay, so we know what we're looking at, what it's going to be, the 70 weeks of Daniel. Okay, by the way, who was this 70 weeks given to? And who is it determined upon? Daniel, and it says in there, his people. So we're talking about the Jewish nation. Okay, that's what we're talking about. Okay, when does this period begin? It says it begins with the command to restore and rebuild Jerusalem. Okay? Now here comes one of the problems that you have, is there are four different commands to restore and rebuild Jerusalem that are made in history. So you got to pick out which one you're going to want. Okay? First, you have Ezra 4, 1 through 4. That scripture is a command to go back and to rebuild the temple. Okay? Then in Ezra 6, you have another period of time or command that was given, and that was again to go back and rebuild the temple. They weren't doing a very good job of getting the job done. In fact, they're criticized at one point because they're busy building their own homes instead of building God's house. The third one comes from Ezra again, 7 verses 11 through 26. And this time, I can't spell Levites, I see. It was to prepare that, to take back gold and silver, to prepare the instruments for worship and for sacrifice. And also to take back animals that they can sacrifice. So this is a more brighter thing, but this is again dealing with the temple. And then you have one last one that's found in Nehemiah. It's Nehemiah 2. If you wanted to read verses 1 through 8, you could. But there they are told to go back. Nehemiah is concerned that they're building, getting the temple built, and they're getting their own homes built. But the walls are not there to protect the people. So he gives the command to go back and to rebuild the walls, to clean the trash out of the streets, to rebuild the city, basically. And so what was the command for? To rebuild Jerusalem. So in all reality, we're talking about this command right here. And that was given in 445 BC. Okay, so that's where we're going to start our time clock and our timeline for the 70 years. Okay? So basically, we're going to get a command, it's recorded in Nehemiah, that they could go back and rebuild Jerusalem. And that was in 445. And so then we have to come across, I'm already giving you a date over here. Did you notice that? 32 AD? Well, there it is. And when this is all done, all 70 weeks, then you will get these results. Okay? From the time, it says, if you're looking at the scripture, it says from the command to rebuild to the Messiah, the prince, is 7 weeks and 62 weeks. Okay? So to add those together, you get 69 weeks to Messiah. Okay? But we have to understand what's meant here and how we work out, and we have to discover some other concepts. So you need to get your calculators again. What is a week? Here mean. We 7 days. Okay. Basically, what this means, it's a period of seven. In the Hebrew language, a week is the plural number, seven. For seven. Okay? So we're talking about seven. Now we don't know what seven that is. Is it seven birds? Seven dogs? Oh, we're talking about time. So is it 7 days? Is it 7 weeks? Literally weeks. Is it 7 months? Is it 7 years? What is it? And so you have to start doing some thinking. And if you want a literal interpretation and start trying to figure these facts out, I'll tell you what it is. Each week is a period of 7 years. It's a period of 7 years. So when you see week, it's a period, it means a period of seven. So that's what we are, 7 years in this case. So we're told that there are 7 weeks and 62 weeks, and that would take us out to 69, which would take us here. Okay? Now you get your calculator. The first week is how long? Or the first 7 year period is how long? Okay. How long is this period of time right here? 7 years times seven. So it comes up to what? Yeah. See, they're doing the math faster back there, and you guys can do it on your calculator. Okay. 49 years. Okay. The 62 weeks, how long is that? Okay. Okay, 434 years. So you total them together and you got 483. The Bible never tells us why he divides it up into 7 and 49. There's all kinds of speculation, but it never really tells you. Okay, so if we look at this right, if we take that 487 years and divide the date or subtract the date we already have, we should come up to what? We're using this number. You take this number and you subtract this number, and that will give you the number. And you're going backwards and counting, and then you'll go past the zero back the other direction. Okay, you take this number here, the total, and subtract this from it. What do you get? 38? That doesn't make sense. Somebody's math is off somewhere. Oh, wait a minute. I got an idea. Just do what I tell you for now, okay? I want you to take 483 times 360. Okay? Put your equal so you've got the answer. Then divide that by 365. Now subtract 445 from that. Yeah, 31 point, boom, 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 boom. That's pretty close to 32. In fact, if you round it up, you get to 32. You know why I did that? Our calendar is based on 365 days. And when you look at numbers like this that we're using, that one and this one, you're looking at our calendar. But the Jewish calendar is different than ours. They only have 360 days in a year. You ever stop and think about that? How do they figure out that and make it work? Because we know it doesn't work. Even 365 doesn't work because we have to throw a leap year in every 4 years. A leap, an extra day. What they do is they follow what is called the lunar calendar. And the lunar calendar consists, a whole cycle of the moon is 29 and a half days. So 1 month will be 30 days, 1 month will be 29. And they have just 12 months. And then every so often they throw in an extra month to bring the calendar back into sync with the seasons. But you've got to, when you're looking at prophecy, always use the year as 360 days. Okay? So you did pretty good. And do you know what, by the way, Many years ago, a scholar named Sir Robert Anderson did a lot of compilations. It's called, I think, The Coming Prince is the book. But he did some complicated compilations. And he went back and looked at the records and discovered that Nehemiah made that decree on the first of Nisan, 445, and exactly 173,880 days later, or 483 years, brought him to the 10th of Nisan in 32. You know what happened that day? What? No. That's when the triumphal entry. Today we're celebrating or commemorating the end of the 69th week. You didn't even realize it, did you? By the way, it came out exact. He did the figures and got it exactly. You know, for years people argued with that number, 32 AD, because they say, no, Jesus died in 30 AD. However, modern scholars, the more they study, are going back to that 32 AD number for Jesus' ride into Jerusalem. Okay, if you wanted it in our dates, it would have been March 4th, 445, to April 6th, 32 AD. Okay, what does it tell you happens, if you've got your Bibles open, after the 69th week? After the 62. It says after the 62 because it's just looking at this period. What happens after that? It says after. Did you get it? Can you... Okay, Messiah will be cut off. That means he's going to be crucified. It also speaks of a prince to come who will destroy Jerusalem and the temple. Now, some people think that's a reference to Titus in 70 AD. The only problem with that is Revelation also speaks of this leader, and Revelation was written after 70 AD. So that's not what we were talking about here. We're talking about a world leader to come yet in the future. There is nothing. The fact that the first 69 weeks have to be taken literally means that 70th week does too. We've got that 1 week, the 70th week left. And that needs to be taken literally too. But in history, we have nothing that corresponds to it, which means it means it's probably still future. Okay? So let's take a look at it. The prince of the people is probably the Antichrist. Okay? We've heard that term. We talked about it last week. By the way, if you're looking at this chart, I want to explain it to you. Okay? This is the 70th week, but we know there's a period in here, and so we leave a little gap down here, and then this is just expanded out, this period, okay? Does that make sense to you? What I believe, and what a lot of scholars believe, is that is the church age. When Messiah was cut off, God started working with a different entity instead of Jews. I'm not saying he isn't still working with the Jewish nation, but his main focus was the church. He gave his power, his spirit, on the day of Pentecost to the church. He established a new body that he was working with, that he's working with today. Now, I don't know if we're being more successful than Jewish nation was, which may be why the end comes. But this is the church age. When the church age ends, then that 70th week is going to start again. And you know what starts that 70th week? That's called a gap principle, and you see it in prophecy all the time. In one verse, the first part of the verse will be here, and the other is going to be fulfilled off here somewhere. And you find that all the time in prophecy because they're looking back here and they don't see that split. Does that make sense to you? If you work with cameras a lot, you see that a lot. You can make two people look like they're standing right together and make it look real weird when they may be a block away until you start messing with things. But when you're looking at something from back here, you don't always see a gap that's there. And that's what we're talking about. Okay? Then we need to decide, well, when does this period begin out here? When can we come out here and say, well, this is what starts the 70th week? Well, the Bible says that too. It says, basically, that the covenant, it begins with a covenant that's made with Israel. Doesn't it say in there, he will confirm the covenant with many, which is Israel, for 1 week. That's your 70th week. Okay? What do we know that of? We call it the tribulation. You know, I told you we were going to eventually find in Daniel how we got 70 weeks for the tribulation. That's where, or years, that's where you get it. Jesus prophesied about this period of time, and I don't have that in your notes. It's in Mark 13, 19. For those days there will be a time of tribulation such as not occurred since the beginning of creation, which God created, until now, nor ever shall be again. It's going to be the worst period of tribulation the world has ever seen. Okay, in the middle of that week, we are told, by the way, we're middle of the week, we're putting 3.5 years in there, so that's half of it, and we find that division all the time here. You're going to find the sacrifice and oblation cease. The first part of the tribulation might not be as bad as we might think in some ways. It will be bad for some of us or some people. But anyway, the Antichrist has been working. He made this covenant with Israel, but he breaks that covenant in the middle of the week. He causes the sacrifices and oblations to cease. Oblations basically are grain offerings. But he causes them to cease. And you know what else he does? Now, this isn't in Daniel, but you'll find it in other places, Thessalonians. Right here in the middle of the week here, he's going to do what Antiochus Epiphanes did that we talked about last week. Remember what he did? He slaughtered a pig in the temple, which is blasphemy. It's considered a dirty animal. And to slaughter a pig in the temple was unheard of. And so that's what's going to happen. And basically after that time, everything's going to break loose. I want to show you, I mean, it's going to be a time like we've never seen, like he said. But I wanted to show you too, this period is divided into two periods. And you see that a lot. In Revelation, it mentions 1,260 days. How long is that? If you divided that by 360, what would you get? 3.5. In Revelation, it mentions 42 months. Divide that in half, or not divide it in half, divide it by 12, and what do you have? 3.5. That 3.5 period keeps coming back. It's 7 weeks, but it's divided into two periods. So it's going to be... Where did I get 49 years? I was sleeping last night, I think. Yeah, it should be one. It's 1 year. 1 week is, yeah. It's 1 week and 7 years. I was asleep last night when I did finish that chart. Yeah, so fix your chart, okay? Put one here and 7 years here, and then that's divided up. Okay, you guys got any questions? Adults, you have any questions that I can't answer? Not that you know of. Okay. Of course, after the 70th week, that seven-year period called the tribulation, Jesus is going to return. And all those things that we mentioned before up there are going to be fulfilled. And again, as we, like Daniel did in studying the book of Jeremiah, realize how close the return is, the second coming is, we need to keep asking ourselves, how am I responding to that? Am I concentrating my life to him every day? Am I seeking his will in my life? Am I striving to live for him? Or am I just ignoring that it's going to happen? You know, if Daniel hadn't sat down and started praying, Israel may have never ever came out of captivity. But God knew Daniel was faithful and he knew what he would do. And hopefully he knows the same thing about us.